Mabuhay po tayong lahat at maraming salamat po.
Thank you very much, President Sergio Ortiz Luis, and for the next part of the program, Lois, please.
We're also honored today to have the presence of our excellent and hard-working partners from the Senate of the Philippines. May I now invite the Honorable Senator Lauren Legarda to deliver her message of support. Ma'am, may you may have the floor.
Thank you very much, and we thank the President for gracing this very important occasion on the launch of the Export Development Plan. DTI Secretary Alfredo Pascual, a special mention because the DTI is the implementing agency of many of my important laws from 1998. I know you're new in DTI, Sec Pascual, but I've talked to you about this many times. From my first term in 1998 till now, the laws that I've authored, including the Magna Carta for MSME, which Sergio Ortiz Luis mentioned, and the OTOP, which I have been filing for several terms, but finally enacted into law, and it's in the BICAM was passed. And the trade agreements, which the President, I'm so grateful, mentioned, including the concurrence in the ratification of the Regional Cooperation Economic Partnership Agreement, and many more. So the DTI holds a very special place in my heart and in my work and in my life because it is the lifeblood of our economy, whether industries or the 99.5% MSMEs. And so I'd like to greet, and I'm happy to meet the ARTA DG Ernesto Perez. It's important that this newly enacted law gets implemented effectively and efficiently. Because if the bureaucratic red tape is a stumbling block in investments, both domestic and foreign, then all of these summits and conferences will be to waste. You must curb, if not cut, the corruption, and curb, if not cut totally, the red tape, the bureaucratic red tape in all aspects of government. And that is the intent of our law. And I'd like to greet everyone. Wag nang isa-isahin. So, as Ernie Ordonez, who was here earlier, said, yes, the die is cast, meaning the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, or RCEP, has been ratified, concurred in by the Senate, and the DTI has submitted the plans required to meet the conditions contained in Senate Resolution 42. I would like to say that this is historic, that this is the first time that the Senate has concurred in an agreement, in a treaty, with such a lengthy resolution mandating agencies like trade and industry and agriculture and NEDA to comply. And that is my commitment to the stakeholders who will be affected by RCEP, including the oppositors. And I must admit, and I'm proud to admit, that I consulted with all those opposed to RCEP, including the Bantay RCEP, so that their concerns are addressed by government. I've always had faith in the skills, creativity, and innovativeness of Filipinos. That has never been the issue plaguing our country, in a reduced capacity to compete. Both the ratification conditions and the way forward now require much more than lip service. It is imperative that we can prove that these benefits touted by the largest economic agreement in recent history can be delivered across a broad range of sectors. I therefore give my support to the Philippine Export Development Plan in its comprehensiveness and its inclusivity, as well as its sharp focus that make us competitive. I have to mention the uniqueness of RCEP, which will be the vehicle for the success of this plan. RCEP is unique because it mentions the Convention on Biological Diversity. Alam ba ninyo, even the CBD was mentioned in RCEP. Kaya nga pumayag akong isponsor ito eh, against all odds. The latest agreement under this convention is a Kunming-Montreal Biodiversity Framework, which has targets that can impact our export ambitions. Growth and expansion of production necessarily bring with it the use of our natural resources. Meanwhile, one target of the framework is to ensure that by year 2030, at least 30% of areas of degraded terrestrial, inland water, and coastal and marine ecosystems are under effective restoration in order to enhance biodiversity and ecosystem functions and services, ecological integrity and connectivity. I therefore urge our export sector and our industries wishing to be a part of this wave of economic opportunity to consider such restoration as a necessary improvement of the capacity of these ecosystems to deliver the products we will enhance and the quality that makes for higher value, more nutritious loads, and less toxicity. Another target should encourage our production to be more efficient and economical by reducing excess nutrients lost to the environment by at least half through more efficient nutrient cycling and use, reducing the overall risk from pesticides and highly hazardous chemicals by at least half through integrated pest management based on science and taking into account food security and sustainable livelihoods. These tenets should make our offerings to the global market more valued. More and more, our consumers are gaining an increased awareness and appreciation of the products that are sustainably produced. Instead of treating this as an insurmountable obstacle, we can leapfrog towards new production mechanisms that avoid waste and that ensures ecological security. This will deliver much more economic benefits in the long term. Let me end by saying that we are in the process of finalizing the provisions of the Philippine Environmental and Natural Capital Accounting System Bill, the PENCAS. All the industries and the associations present here, of course, know this because it is not a new concept. The United Nations has used PENCAS and the NEDA has done this decades ago, but it's not yet been enacted. Thus, I am championing it. This bill will help us with decision making as to which products will give us a competitive advantage while ensuring clean and sustainable production processes. We cannot seek unlimited growth on a finite planet. Hence, the challenge is to add value to the things we produce, both by ingenuity, better craftsmanship and quality, as well as the social benefits, including fair and just working conditions and pricing that accounts for the externalities. So I'm only allotted 5 minutes and I'm over that. All I can say is that it is an exciting yet challenging time to be entering this arena. We have to show the world who we are by integrating all these challenges into our engagement with the global economy. And I believe in our people. I believe so much in our capacity of our government to deliver. So to the DTI family and all its attached bureaus and agencies, to the efficient women and men of DTI and our export sector as well, know that your senator who has authored many of the trade and industries laws already being implemented by government, is here to support you and in support of the Philippine Development Plan, Philippine Export Development Plan. Mabuhay, isang lunti ang Pilipinas sa ating lahat.
Thank you, Senator Legarda, for that inspiring message of support. I've closely followed you as you championed legislations pertaining to trade and RCEP. So we appreciate all your support extended to the development of our entrepreneurs and exporters. The endorsement of our export leaders and champions today signifies a crucial step forward, not just for the development of our exporters, but for the collective call of our government to make things happen for our exporters. Thanks again, Senator Legarda.
Thank you very much, Senator Legarda and the President, Sergio Ortiz Luis Jr. We will have a 5-minute coffee break and then we'll proceed for the next part of our program. Maraming salamat po. Good morning again, everyone. Can I request everyone to please settle in? We'll proceed for the next part of the program. Thank you. Hello, good morning. My name is Jeremiah C. Reyes. I'm from the DTI Foreign Trade Service Corps, Department of Trade and Industry, and I'll be your moderator MC for this part of the program. For our first session for this part of the program, we will be talking about the trade and investment opportunities in the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. And we will be joined by the set of esteemed speakers from our RCEP partner countries. For the second panel, our partners from the private sector, as well as our policymakers, will be taking part in the discussions on opportunities, challenges, and leveraging on the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. For the first session, we are honored to have today no less than His Excellency Ambassador Huang Xilian, Embassy of the People's Republic of China in the Republic of the Philippines, to deliver his remarks. Mr. Ambassador, thank you.
Excellency President Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr., Honorable Secretary Alfredo Pascual, Honorable Field Export President ODZ Rules, dear friends from the business circle, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. It is a great pleasure to be invited to this international trade forum. I would like to congratulate the DTI and Secretary Pascual for organizing this event, and I'm confident that the Philippine Export Development Plan 2023-2028 will lead to enhanced international trade of the Philippines, as I look forward to growing trade between China and the Philippines. We have seen in recent years gratifying results yielded by China-Philippines economic and trade relations. China has been the largest trading partner for the Philippines for 7 consecutive years. According to Chinese statistics, in 2022, the import and export volume between our two countries reached $87.7 billion. And the trade would chalk up about $111.5 billion if the volume includes that with Hong Kong, Macau, and Taiwan of China. Bananas and pineapples from the Philippines make up more than 90% of Chinese imports of fruits. Earlier this year, fresh durians, very popular among Chinese people, have added to coconuts, avocado, and frozen fruits in entering Chinese markets. China international imports, exports, China ASEAN exports, and the Canton Fair, among other events, have become important platforms for Philippine SMEs to sell products to China market. Last year, the Philippine sale at the 5th CIIE alone exceeded a record of $600 million. China and the Philippines signed a memorandum of understanding on e-commerce cooperation and a mutual recognition authenticated operators agreement, allowing more companies from both sides to enjoy digital dividends and easy customs clearance. What's more, when most economies are under pressure of inflation, Chinese products known for quality and steady supply have played a positive role in mitigating the inflation for the Philippines and the rest of the world. On June 2nd, RCEP officially takes effect in the Philippines, which marks a new stage of development of the free trade zone with the largest population, the largest economic and trade scale, and the most development potential in the world. China-Philippines economic and trade cooperation is facing unprecedented opportunities with the following implications. First, larger markets. Under the guidance of the regional unified market, the doors of the Chinese market will open wider with the increasing demand of Chinese customers and manufacturers. Commodities and raw materials with higher quality and lower price, such as durian, will be more accessible in other parts of the region. Second, lower cost. Relying on the cumulative result of the rules of origin, China will further reduce tariffs on more commodities from the Philippines, such as canned pineapple, pineapple juice, coconut juice, and pepper. China will promote customs facilitations to improve the efficiency of the cross-border logistics through information technology. Many SMEs, especially agricultural products traders in the Philippines, will enjoy customs clearance convenience and better tariff concession. Number three, more investment. Regional investment cooperation will further improve the Philippine business environment and increase investment confidence of RCEP member countries in the Philippines. The accelerating free flow of capital, technology, talents, information, and data will promote the integration of the Chinese and the Philippine production and supply chains, enhance the global competitiveness of Chinese and Philippine products, services, and technology, and create more job opportunities for our two countries with the signature and earnest implementation of RCEP. China will work with the Philippines to support the multilateral trade regime, promote economic openness, and contribute to a strong, balanced, sustainable, and inclusive development of world economy. Ladies and gentlemen, earlier this year, during his visit to China, President Marcos and President Xi Jinping reached a series of important consensus on deepening our mutually beneficial cooperation in various fields, prioritizing agriculture, infrastructure, energy, and people-to-people exchanges between China and the Philippines. Both our governments should implement the consensus reached by the two heads of state, adhere to principles of independence and good neighborliness and friendship, seize opportunities for economic development in the post-pandemic era, and release the dividends of the RCEP system so as to bring more benefits to the peoples of the Philippines and China. Thank you, and mabuhay.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Wang, for that enriching discussions in understanding the immense opportunities in RCEP. Together, it is our hope that we will reap the benefits of the agreement. It is also important to note that you mentioned some of the benefits of the agreement, like lower costs and greater market access. With that, let's make it happen together. For the next part of our set of speakers, may I now invite the Minister for Economic Affairs of the Embassy of Japan in the Philippines, Mr. Nihei Daisuke. Daisuke-san, you may now have the floor. Thank you.
Honorable DTS Secretary Alfredo Pascual, His Excellency Chinese Ambassador Wan Sirian, Honorable President of Philippine Export, Mr. Sergio Otis Ruiz, Honorable Senators, EDC members, officials of the DTI, members of the private sector, distinguished guests and ladies and gentlemen, Magandang umaga po, good morning. First of all, allow me to express my heartfelt gratitude and appreciation to the DTI for successfully convening this great event or forum today. It gives us the opportunity to engage with our government officials and members of the export industries who are working tirelessly to strengthen the relationship between our countries. The recent entry into force of the largest free trade agreement, the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, RCEP, has been strongly led by ASEAN. It aims to incentivize the supply chains and eliminate tariffs of 92% of trade of goods, as well as introduce rules on investment to promote free trade and investment across the region, and voting tremendous opportunities for the member countries, including the Philippines, of course. The RCEP is a multilateral agreement of great significance in that it covers not only trading goods and services, but also involves new rules, including intellectual property or e-commerce, even though the participating countries are in a different status of economic development. In addition, the agreement, this agreement of RCEP, is complementing existing multiple free trade agreements in the regions with this single agreement. This agreement provides harmonized rules of origins across all the member countries in the region, and also this agreement is expected to strengthen the regional supply chain and further deepen the partnership among the member countries, including, of course, the Philippines and Japan. Together with the recent reforms of rules or regulations, those reforms of several regulations in the Philippines have created favorable conditions for the Philippine business sector, and the anticipated increase of investments in trade and energy from foreign entities, including that of from Japanese companies, shows how far we have come as close partners of the Philippines in business and beyond. During the recent visit of President Ferdinand Marcos to Japan last February, Japanese Prime Minister Kishida Fumio vowed to support the Philippines to attain upper middle income country status by 2025, in line with the Philippine Development Plan for 2023 to 2028. This announcement from the Prime Minister Kishida is through the active contribution, is going to come true or realized through the active contribution of official development assistance, ODA, from Japan, as well as from the private sector investment. For the private sectors, pronouncements from various Japanese companies or firms, such as manufacturing, green energy, and infrastructure businesses, have yielded $13 billion investment pledges that would create 24,000 jobs in the country. I believe the core strengths of our country's relationship lies in our people. Everyone, all of you who are participating in this forum reflects how much we can achieve when we work together. It likewise serves as a big vote of confidence on the Philippine economy and this region as a whole. The Philippine economy has been growing and moving forward in leaps and bounds, and the government of Japan is here to support the Philippines and make sure it maintains the momentum towards the faster and more inclusive growth and development. Together, we will strengthen and take advantage of the partnership we have long enjoyed between the Philippines and Japan. Thank you very much, and mabuhay.
Japan has been one of the staunch supporters of regional economic integration, especially in bridging understanding
of the new areas of economic relations and our dynamic relationship. For the next part, allow me to introduce DTI's poster boy for RCEP, who needs no further introduction. May I now call on Assistant Secretary Alan Hepti to deliver his remarks on how the Philippines can take advantage of the agreement. Asak Alan, please.
Maraming salamat, Jeremy. Good morning, everyone. Let me start by saying that we are in the midst of complex challenges. On the economic front, for example, one big challenge is the adverse effects brought about by the pandemic, compounded by the rising cost of production, inflation, and even adherence to a rules-based system of trade and investments. Globalization in itself is being questioned, and some would even submit a protectionist policy. However, given the fact that the world is now integrated in all aspects, the question is, can an economy really afford to embrace an inward economic policy? The debate on globalization has long passed. We have crossed the Rubicon River, and we can no longer reverse it. The only way to advance is to move forward together and seize the opportunities along the way. When the Philippines was working for its participation in the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement, there was a renewed discussion, not to say debate, on whether or not a free trade agreement has worked in favor of the country and whether or not the RCEP agreement can best serve our interests, particularly our local industries. There were a lot of exchanges about trade deficit, export performance, competitiveness, unfair competition, and even government support. Notwithstanding, we see these exchanges and discussions as welcome developments because they have brought us together to reflect, recalibrate, regroup, and work together to face the challenges we are all in. We hope to sustain this collaboration with the end view of reaping the benefits of our collective efforts. Now, with our participation in RCEP, the basic question is, what is the competitive advantage of the Philippines so that it can fare well in the largest free trade arena? To answer this, I would like to highlight that the RCEP agreement, like any other FTAs, is a policy tool intended to promote and facilitate trade and investment in a more conducive business environment. This basically means providing market access as well as stability and predictability in doing business in the free trade area. Market access because one has to open the market with less barriers to facilitate flow of goods and services. This will encourage demand and consequently more production to sell more in a bigger market and provide necessary services. This means more investments, more jobs, more taxes, and more programs and projects for the government. Stability and transparency because the rules and disciplines agreed upon by the parties will provide assurance and predictability to businesses and foreign investors. In the process, there will surely be competition and risk. What is important is that we find our niche, our competitive advantage. We can focus on where we have the advantage, be more innovative, and optimize the benefits one sector at a time. Citing the article of economist Michael E. Porter in the Harvard Business Review, A Competitive Advantage of Nation, and I quote, "A nation's competitiveness depends on the capacity of its industry to innovate and upgrade. Companies gain advantage against the world's best competitors because of pressure and challenge. They benefit from having strong domestic rivals, aggressive home-based suppliers, and demanding local customers. In a world of increasingly global competition, nations have become more, not less important, as the basis of competition has shifted more and more to the creation and assimilation of knowledge, the role of the nation has grown. There are striking differences in the patterns of competitiveness in every country. No nation can or will be competitive in every or even most industries. Ultimately, nations succeed in particular industries because their home environment is the most forward-looking, dynamic, and challenging. Unquote. For the Philippines, its participation in RCEP signifies the country's dynamism, willingness to face bigger challenges, and resolve to explore and seize opportunities in the region. Its participation is also a manifestation of its continued commitment to regional integration and to a rules-based international order. Today, the RCEP region is the most economically dynamic in the world, home to competitive economies which are leaders in their respective fields of comparative advantages. It is the main GBC hubs of China, Japan, and South Korea, and most importantly, it is an ASEAN-led FTA. Under the current setting, with China, Japan, and South Korea as key partners in the area of innovation, manufacturing, and technological capability, and ASEAN at the core of economic activities from conceptualization to commercialization, my submission is that Philippines can bank more on its people, place, policy direction, and prospects. On people, we are most acutely aware of the advantages. The Philippines benefits from a youthful demographic structure relative to the rest of the region. With a median age of 25.3 years, the Philippines has a significantly younger population than most of its neighbors. This implies a young English-speaking workforce with the necessary skill set for the Industry 4.0 economy. These young people will form the basis of consumption-led growth for the coming decades. Notably, only 8.5% of the population is age 60 and above, indicating relative stable demographics for the foreseeable future. This is in contrast to many of our neighbors who will soon have to contend with the prospect of getting old before reaching high income status. In RCEP, we have to note that this FTA is not just about trading goods or simply about export and imports of products. It also includes opportunities for our professionals and service providers. Trade in services is indeed a growing key interest of the Philippines, being the main GDP contributor. Market access commitments under trade in services in RCEP allow deeper commitments than those in other FTAs and provide greater openness and certainty for Filipino businesses, particularly in promoting export opportunities abroad. Preferential access to the markets of the 14 other parties was further secured for Filipino service providers across a number of sectors, such as legal services, ICT, education, transportation, professional, construction, tourism, insurance, banking, and distribution services, among others. In sum, my message is, as we hurdle the Herculean challenge of our trade deficit in goods, let us optimize the opportunities in the services sector and level up our involvement to being service providers, entrepreneurs, and innovators. On place, this refers not just to the Philippines' physical location, but also its complementarities and positioning within the global economy. In this respect, the Philippines benefits from a relatively strategic position in terms of linkages and ties to other major economies. RCEP is a key component of the Philippines' network of trade arrangements, which include the EU-GSP+, the UK-DCTS, PH-EFTA-FTA, and hopefully, sooner rather than later, the reauthorization of the US-GSP. Not all ASEAN member states are part of the preferential trade arrangement with these key markets, which gives us an advantage relative to our ASEAN neighbors. Thus, in terms of attracting investments, even non-RCEP parties can view the Philippines as a strategic location to access a bigger market by setting up manufacturing facilities in the country and export these products in the region. In addition, foreign investors in manufacturing can also look into the opportunities brought about by the other preferential trade arrangements of the Philippines. For the RCEP region, the enhanced rules on transparency, trade facilitation provisions such as advance rulings, expeditious release of goods, use of information technology for customs clearance, self-certification by approved exporters are expected to lessen administrative costs and shipment delays at the border. Just to highlight on self-certification by approved exporters, Philippine exporters may apply for approved exporter status to the Bureau of Customs. Once granted, approved exporters are authorized to issue its own origin declaration when trading with RCEP parties, compared to the usual practice where exporters apply to the BOC for certificates of origin for every shipment. This scheme removes the step of having to transact with BOC for every export shipment. We strongly encourage Philippine exporters to register with the BOC for this scheme as it is envisaged to increase utilization of the RCEP agreement. Our agriculture sector should also see opportunities in the RCEP agreement. In addition to the improved market access gained in this agreement, they must take advantage of wider cumulation area, trade facilitative measures, and even promotion of investments in smart agriculture, training, and research and development. Kindly note that in our schedule of commitments, we have basically come up with a more lenient market access on these subsectors. In terms of physical geography, the Philippines also benefits not just from strategic position for economies like China, Japan, and Korea, but also as a natural hub for trans-Pacific contact with North America. It is well positioned to be the hub of operations for highly technology sectors such as electronics and semiconductors. With businesses now more aware of the importance of supply chain resilience, this trend is likely to accelerate. On the same vein, the opening of the telecommunications sector for foreign ownership and the fact that several trans-Pacific internet cables have landing stations in the Philippines bolster the readiness of the country to embrace a robust digital economy. Under RCEP, the comprehensive chapters on telecommunication, financial services, and e-commerce can pave the way for attracting more investments and service providers in the said industries, as well as promote the development of value-added services. On policies, the Philippines has demonstrated a clear direction of openness and adaptability to the changing times and the demand of its stakeholders. In recent years, the Philippines has enacted key economic reforms relating to both taxation and foreign investments. For example, the CREATE Act slash corporate taxes and rationalize incentive structures for both local and foreign investment. Amendments to the Retail Trade Liberalization Act, Foreign Investment Act, and the Public Services Act have also opened new sectors to foreign ownership or otherwise rationalized requirements for foreign investors. In fact, in the implementing rules and regulation of the Public Service Act just went into effect last April 3 of this year. Renewable energy on certain sources, that is, such as solar, tidal, and wind, was also open to 100% foreign ownership last year. This year, renewable energy investments alone are expected to account for one-third of approved investment by the BOI. Even education, the passage of the Transnational Higher Education Act encourages more collaboration and partnership with foreign educational institutions. This complements our commitments in the RCEP agreement, and I hope we can take advantage of this opportunity. To add, the country can also has a good positioning when it comes to IP protection and enforcement. And noting our growing ecosystem for innovation, we hope to promote more economic development in the country. In sum, the Philippines has the right blend of policies to create a conducive environment for business and for growth. Likewise, there is much potential and prospect for Philippine industries, especially industries of key importance to the ongoing clean energy transition and emerging knowledge industries. The country's burgeoning business process outsourcing industry, a sector which is set to directly employ 2 million people by 2028, will continue to be a source of strength for the economy, absorbing talent and facilitating the transition of our workers to higher value-added work critical for Industry 4.0. The Philippine semiconductor and electronics industry is also already a key player in the outsourced semiconductor assembly and test space. This sector is poised to absorb locators from continental Asia. Still, there is much room for growth in this sector, particularly if we are able to make inroads in other parts of the semiconductor supply chain, such as integrated circuit design and wafer fabrication. The most promising prospects are those in sectors which remain largely untapped. There is highly potential for complementarity with global supply chain demands in battery and green metal industries. The Philippines is the second largest supplier of nickel in the world after Indonesia. This metal is a key component of green technologies, particularly batteries and EV cathodes. There is also untapped potential for rare earth minerals, key to high technology industries. Our smartphones contain substantial amounts of these rare earth minerals. Interestingly, the Philippines currently produces cobalt and scandium, largely as byproducts of mining. With additional investments, the Philippines can supply much of the demand for companies seeking to diversify their sourcing of these critical minerals. In summary, the Philippines' dynamic workforce, strategic location, economic reforms, and trade and investment policies, it is well positioned to be a manufacturing hub, center for training and education, research and development, innovation, and investment hub in the region. Maraming salamat po.
Thank you very much, Assistant Secretary Alan Hepti, for a very enlightening remarks. We are all excited for the country to take part in the opportunities provided in the RCEP. We will now proceed for a panel discussion with a new set of speakers. Once I call your name, can I invite you to go in front and join me at the stage? First one is Undersecretary Seferino Rodolfo, Undersecretary DTI Industry Development and Trade Policy Group, Assistant Secretary Glenn Peñaranda, DTI Trade Promotions Group, Mr. Ferdinand Perry Ferrer, Chairman and CEO, EMS Group of Companies, and also a Phil Export Trustee for the electronic sector. And lastly, Mr. George Barcelon, President, Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry. Thank you very much, gentlemen. For this part of the program, we will request each member of our panel to deliver a 3-minute opening remarks, 3 to 5 minutes, sir. And we'll proceed with the Q&A. So first, I'll invite Undersecretary Perry Rodolfo to deliver his
Thank you very much, and good morning to colleagues, friends, partners, and collaborators. First of all, maybe when we talk about challenges and opportunities. Challenges present opportunities if we are able to address these challenges correctly. One of the things that is, has been happening in the Philippines has been our 2023 first quarter growth of 6.4%, a bit slower than the 2022 growth for our GDP. But nevertheless one of the fastest in the world, if not the fastest. I think in our region, in Asia at least, we registered the fastest growth for the first quarter. This is despite all the challenges, headwinds, including, for example, global conflicts and their impact on supply chains, and big country markets resort to protectionist policies to reshore production facilities. Now, so in summary, there is uncertainty in the global market, but we have strong economic growth due to the resiliency and robustness of our domestic market. So the challenge for us, and this is where we can turn the challenge into an opportunity, is how are we able, or how will we be able to fulfill the growing domestic demand with fulfilling them with local production rather than constantly just importing? Because one of the things that we can really see in terms of our economic indicators would be the widening trade deficit. So now for exports, maybe we can broadly categorize our exports into number one, inputs or components that form part of the global value chain, and number two, another categorization will be finished product. But for both, but most especially for inputs for global value chains, efficiency and cost competitiveness is the key. That is why, for example, there has been a strong focus in the first year of this administration to address important issues, basically implementation issues for the game-changing reform laws that were introduced during the tail end of the previous administration. You would recall that we have been able to address the economic managers, of course, the SEC Fred, and being an important leader in the economic managers, they were able to address issues on VAT, tsaka yung work from home for BPOs. So there are still lingering issues there, but I would say mga for 80% of our exporters na solve na natin yung mga issues. So yung the remaining 20% yung kailangan nating address. Now, for finished products, the main task, I think, is to fulfill domestic demand and gain economies of scale in order to be globally competitive. This is where role of industrial policy is very important. For example, we can take advantage of new industries such as yung electric vehicle industry. So we can leapfrog from yung ICE, the internal combustion engine type of cars, and go directly to electric vehicles. Now, within the context of the four industrial clusters which were mentioned in our PEDP, what is increasingly becoming apparent is that there is very clear opportunity for the Philippines to be the regional hub for, and I mentioned this during the MAP forum about two months ago, to be the regional hub for sustainability, connectivity, and innovation-driven manufacturing and services. Now, within this context, a very important enabler that will serve as a base would be the use of renewable energy in the Philippines. What is previously a source of disadvantage, that is power cost, high power cost, could now really be a big advantage for the Philippines as the world now puts not just a premium on sustainability, but sustainability has become an imperative. So this really levels the playing field for the Philippines vis-a-vis neighbors who may be more blessed when it comes to fossil fuel-based power. Now, another focus that we can have would be on green metals, as was mentioned earlier by ASEC Alan Hepti. We need to be able to add more value here in the Philippines for minerals that are now very important for battery manufacturing. Let me stop there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Yusek Perry. Can I now call on Mr. George Barcelon to deliver your remarks?
Good morning. It's indeed a pleasure to be here, seated beside our hardworking DTI, Yusek Perry and ASEC Glenn. And together with my colleagues here in PCCI, Vice President Perry, to share our thoughts regarding the RCEP. The Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership Agreement, which brought together 15 countries of the Asia-Pacific, covering almost a third of the world's population, and global GDP, and forming the largest trade bloc in the world, heralds the dawn of the Asian century. RCEP is the writing of history of Asian century by opening trade routes and enabling greater international cooperation. I must congratulate our legislators and policy makers for our country's ascension in bringing this momentous trade agreement into force. As our earlier speakers have mentioned, RCEP provides a basis for broader regional integration through improvement in market share, more coherent trade facilitation and regulatory rules and cooperation. It creates new trade opportunities and is set to accelerate the region's economic recovery. RCEP has much to add value to our local businesses and to our people and to our economy. Enhanced trade facilitation measures that make cross-border trade simpler and more efficient. A single set of rules of origin in order to avail of preferential market access. The reduction of tariff of traded goods across the region. All of this means better opportunities for the MSMEs to access cheaper raw material while also reducing barrier to many markets. This would enable them to offer their services of products globally and greater participation in the global value chain. In terms of market access, RCEP will have beneficial impact to food exports because especially in the our banana and also pineapple to markets as Japan, China, and South Korea, which are key markets for the Philippines. As DTI has pointed out, tariffs for preserved pineapples exported to Japan will decrease to 0% within about a decade, compared to the 24% under the Philippine-Japan Economic Partnership Agreement, or PEDP. Similarly, durian and papaya exports to Korea will be tariff-free also within a decade, compared to the current tariff rate of 36 and 24% respectively. Lower tariff will also help Philippine fruits tap other markets, such as Australia and New Zealand. But for this to be realized, the government of the RCEP member countries must commit towards reducing non-tariff barriers, or at least agree on a uniform quality standard for food and other manufactured products across the region. Of course, there's concern regarding the RCEP. That's why it has been delayed in the ratification. But I would like to think that with all the support that's coming from the government, especially in DTI, that we should be able to weather the challenges. We have skilled professionals and business persons in construction, engineering, and banking services, which will be given preferential treatment to practice their professions in participating countries. Seafarers, teachers, ICT programmers, nurses will also benefit due to the demand of labor scarce Japan, Korea, and soon to be China. Companies that have resources are ready to diversify could capitalize on the RCEP through investment in the RCEP membership country. We have now seen companies like Aboitiz and the Ayala have now entered in some of these markets. In joining the RCEP, we have to work harder. The reality is, yes, we are interested in capturing markets among the 15 countries, but in the same token, they are also interested in capturing our market. Okay, the Philippines has a market of about 110 million, which is not small, which is the second in the ASEAN region. So we have to be able to entice potential investors to invest in Philippine-based products, minerals, and other resource-based sectors. But most importantly, in manufacturing. Yesterday, we had a meeting with one of the top executives of U.S. Chamber of Commerce. And we are very happy that he has expressed to work with PCCI because they have been active in promoting businesses that has been investing in Vietnam and also Indonesia. So with that, we're very hopeful that the RCEP, together with the support of the government, that in the next few years, that we will make a difference in our exports. Maraming salamat po. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Barcelon. I'll proceed now with Assistant Secretary Glenn Peñaranda. Sir.
Thank you, Jeremy. Magandang umaga po sa ating lahat. I represent the group in DTI that is, together with the group of the SECPERI, deeply involved in the formulation and also in the implementation of the PEDP. As we pursue opportunities opened up by RCEP, and other markets that we have opened through our FTA agreements. It is very important that we have the whole of country rallied today by the President himself working together. The PEDP is a bold plan, and we have set very ambitious targets, and that is why it's very important that we all work together. As emphasized by Secretary Pascual, there are several things that we need to do, and I'd like to mention the most important ones. First is that we have to develop our industries so that we can produce or provide goods and services that are competitive locally and also internationally. And secondly, it is very important, as Undersecretary Perry has emphasized, that we attract investments. In many instances, because I'm also part of the Foreign Trade Service Corps, we find companies who want to import a lot of our good products and services, and in many instances, we lack the capacities. A good example is this recent opportunity for us to export durian. China can buy everything we have, but that opens up a lot of opportunities. And speaking to SAP earlier today, he said, everyone is planting durian now. No, and so it's one of those opportunities. And thirdly, is really to create a conducive environment that will allow our enterprises to thrive domestically and also to compete internationally. Secretary Pascual has emphasized the approach of an industry development approach. It will be a long and iterative process, but one of the things that we really need to do is to change the mindset that instead of just selling what we have, we actually promote and leverage on our capabilities. I think a good example is in the IT BPM. When companies engage the Philippines, they start with contact center or a basic function. But in dealing with our workers, our technical people, they realize the capabilities and great potential that we can do. And so more and more value-added services actually develop from a single engagement on contact centers. Admittedly, we have a limited variety or range of export products. But we all know that we have very good products also, and we provide excellent service all over the world. And so we have to leverage on our technology, our capabilities, and especially our human resources, which many of our RCEP neighboring countries lack. So we can promote what we have and also what we can, and there is a lot more waiting for us. Thank you.
Thank you, ASEC. Glenn, last but not the least, Mr. Ferrer, please, your opening statement.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting us, being here. Well, in the past year, we've seen the greatest salesman travel the world, which is our president. President Ferdinand Marcos has traveled to different countries and has given credibility and confidence to the business community that the Philippines is again ready and open for business. You know, when you look at the global market, you've seen the shift in manufacturing from different regions to different regions. So the shift is happening, it is real, in a very fast pace. And we believe the ASEAN members will be the center of innovation, the center of technology, the center of manufacturing. And we in the Philippines, we're right in the middle, geographically, we're in the middle between the East and the West. And as we've heard earlier, we have the population, we have the skilled workforce, and the businesses now in the Philippines are focused on providing ease of doing business, which is very attractive. That's why with all that, I believe the Philippines, this is our decade to shine and attract more investors. I represent the electronic sector for the Philippine Exports Confederation. And we heard earlier, our sector in 2022 exported $49 billion. Again, the largest exporter in the Philippines. In one half, that is good. But where we fail is we are still far from the exports of Vietnam, which is 1.7 times. We're still far from the exports of Indonesia, which is over twice. So I believe with all the what we have heard on all the legislation and improvements and corrections, now is the time for the Philippines to capture a lot of that moving manufacturing sites globally. We should also include the non-export manufacturing companies as part of the supply chain. In the past, we've been focused on export zones, expertise and competencies in the export zones. Now, I believe we should expand. There's a lot of competencies outside the export zones that we should bring them inclusively within the supply chain. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. Your understanding and analysis of RCEP and then the Philippine Export Development Plan has actually sparked some conversations online, which I keep on receiving some of the questions from our audience. So I'll start now with some of the questions we received. So earlier on, Mr. Ferrer mentioned about there are a lot of opportunities for export to actually leapfrog, citing the examples of Vietnam, citing the examples of Indonesia. So I'll throw this question to Yusek Perry. Yusek Perry, what do you think are the necessary measures for the government to pass for us to be able to maximize the tools, the opportunities presented to us by RCEP and, of course, the PEDP?
Thank you very much. Just to step back a bit, siguro, let me cite a favorite framework that we have in DTI. It's called Pascual's five P's. Letter P, first P, policy. Next P is projects and programs. Then you have promotion, people development. And then you have partnerships. Hindi pwedeng isa lang. When you talk about how do we take advantage of this opportunity that RCEP is opening up to us, kailangan whole of government approach in all of these five P's. So just a quick example, in being able to draw in investments, we need to have the right policy framework. So in the previous administration, there were game-changing reforms, as I mentioned earlier, from CREATE to the PS opening of or further liberalizing of the public services sector, retail trade, tapos Foreign Investments Act. Now we're in the stage of implementing this, and naturally, there were some gray areas that we have been able to already address and clarify through the help, as I said earlier, of the economic managers, yung mga VAT issue, work from home. Although may mga lingering pa, so I would say mga 20% pa yung kailangan nating i-address. So that's very important. Equally important yung opening of the or removing of the foreign equity restriction on renewable energy. So that's one. And then yung projects and programs, very important then in particular as it relates to the other P, yung people development. It has always been said, and si kudos pala kay Architect June Palafox, I watched your YouTube interview, sir, yung Vision 2050, where it was really highlighted. And wherever we go, kahit saan magsalita, si Sec Fred, si Presidente, what is being highlighted is really the demographic profile of the Philippines. Of course, dun sa interview, sir, ay naalala ko, tinanong kayo, di ba? It can be a double-edged sword, di ba? Parang pwede siyang, if you're not able to sufficiently empower and upskill your young population, it can be a hindrance to growth. But ang nakikita ko kasi natin, wherever you go, yung mga, it's very, for those whose demographic profile has turned an upside down pyramid, very difficult for them to reverse. At least tayo, meron tayong basic resource that we can work on and work with. So yon, it's a challenge, but at the same time, an opportunity. And then the other P is promo. Very important yung ating Make It Happen campaign. Kaya nga, halimbawa, yung roadshow ni Sec. Fred sa Europe, halo din yung policy and promo. Pagpunta niya sa France for next week, it will be a JEC, yung ating bilateral platform in engaging partners with France. Tapos pupunta siya sa UK. Again, another policy, promotion and policy. And then, very important yung pagpunta niya sa Brussels para dun sa ating sustaining the EU GSP Plus, tsaka yung advocating further yung Philippines EU FTA, and then Netherlands and Germany. And we're very happy that in all of those, kasama natin ang private sector. So CAP will be there, PCCI, at saka IBPAP. And then partnerships. So again, what we have here. So it's not just a single policy, single thing that we have to do, but a whole of government effort on the five P's. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Yusek Perry. Similar to that response of yours, actually, there are certain programs and policies that in the department has been laid down. So I'll throw now the question to Asek Glenn. So Asek Glenn, since we're talking about RCEP and we're trying to use RCEP as a tool to further our exports, can you tell us what are the programs that we intend to do in the DTI to help our exports? And of course, we also have our stakeholders here who are asking how we can help them. So can you also introduce the policies, the programs that we have in the DTI for them to tap?
Okay, thank you, Jeremy. The PEDP has outlined already our objectives and also the key strategies. So then there are two things that we need to emphasize. First is that we need to prioritize. We know the sectors that are the key sectors that contribute much to the exports. But this is not to exclude other sectors, because for industry support, we will provide essential services such as policy support, commercial intelligence, and also trade facilitation. The president talked earlier about untapped export potential, and a lot of these are actually opportunities that we could have pursued if we knew. So that's one area that we need to really strengthen on, provide commercial intelligence so that our exporters can avail of these opportunities. Secretary Pascual, the DTI, and this is all reflected in the PDP and also in the PEDP about the clusters that we will be promoting. In addition to the essential services, highlighted also in the PEDP is the what we call stratified services that we will provide for the target sectors. And this will depend on the maturity of the enterprises. The Secretary has always emphasized that we cannot have one package service for all, but we have to understand exactly the situation of the enterprises and their size. Is this micro, small, medium, and develop the services that DTI can offer. For us in the Trade Promotions Group, we have the services that we think our stakeholders will need to pursue opportunities. Together with our Regional Operations Group, the Trade Promotions Group of DTI can assist our stakeholders throughout the life cycle from enterprise to export. We have what we call the enterprise to export pathways, and in every stage of that cycle, DTI will be there. Let me just highlight some of the things that we can do. First is that we can provide capacity building for the local market, and we have for this the Philippine Trade Training Center, who can provide training. And then we also have the Design Center of the Philippines, who can do product development, help them with packaging. And then, of course, as I mentioned, because our frontline really are our regional operations group, we have regional and provincial offices, which is our frontline for stakeholders. Now, if they have the capability, we have to assist them to access the local market. So we have programs like Auto, Go Local, and we bring them to mainstream markets like Manila. For those who are now doing well in the regions, we bring them to the national trade fairs. And then later on, those who are doing very well domestically, we also prepare them to go to the export market. So the next will be capacity building for export readiness. Again, PTTC will be there, the Science Center, and of course, the Export Marketing Bureau, which is our export promotion agency. Now, for those who are now doing well domestically, and we need to also assist them as they prepare for the regional and global market. So we have, again, the whole TIPG, EMB, including now SITEM, who organizes trade exhibitions and missions to bring our best products and services to the global market. I'd like to add that the Philippines, the DTI, has 29 offices in 23 countries in most of the major markets and major sources of investments of the country. This is the what we call the concierge of services that we will provide to all our stakeholders. But the one thing that we need to do very quickly is to have what we call experts network, which we will set up in the regions together with maybe in the negotiation centers, which is really the front line for our stakeholders. In the coming months, we will be training these export experts so that they will be there to serve our stakeholders. In this endeavor, it is very important that we get the support of our private sector partners. And I'm sure George of PCCI, Phil Export, and the other business organizations will be one with us in developing the support system so that we can really assist many of our stakeholders.
Thank you, ASEC Glenn. ASEC Glenn highlighted partnership. Also, USEC Perry highlighted partnership and collaboration with the private sector. So my next question will be for Mr. Barcelon and Mr. Ferrer. First is, what are you confident about RCEP? And second is, how are you preparing for RCEP? For Mr. George, how is the private sector preparing for RCEP, noting that we are already implementing RCEP since the start of this month? And for Mr. Ferrer, how is EMS and the electronic sector in general is preparing for RCEP? I'll start first with Mr. George.
You know, RCEP is another dynamic regarding globalization, okay? Wherein we really have to prepare ourselves to be competitive. And there are areas that we need to, there are gaps that we need to help, especially a lot of our members in the export community are small and medium. And one area that we are in a way short is that the proper financing for these companies. 2 days ago, we had Exporters Confederation had a general membership meeting, and we invited the stakeholder in the financing, Union Bank, SB Corp, and some other government agencies regarding this aspect. I think that one thing that was shared with us by one of the speaker from Banco Central is the initiation of start of having a credit standing of various companies. And that's one area that we're lacking, wherein the banks sometimes are hesitant. And that's why we have a lot of unbankable. So financing is definitely a sector and one area that we have to really improve to help our exporter and also the small and the micro establishment. The other area that is very important for us is the reality of helping the small establishment is in the lessening the bureaucracy. The ease of doing business, I think, is the top of mind of not only of the local businessmen, but also foreign investors or foreign companies that are here. A week ago, we had a meeting with the European Chamber of Commerce. And you know, one of the UK, Netherlands, they're all major investors in our country. And we can sense that they are happy to be here. They find it challenging to navigate in the with the local government. And we find that this has to be addressed. And we are happy that next week, for the general membership of PCCI. We have invited Secretary Ben Hur, Secretary of Local Government, and we have invited Secretary Nes Perez, Director General of ARTA. And we want the meeting to be focused on area, how the local government. You know, a lot of foreign investors, when they come, they always, the first choice is they want to be in PESA. Why? Because the rule of law, things really gets moving fast. And I encourage, during the presentation of our Philippine Economic Development Plan by Secretary R.C. Balisakan, I mentioned that the local government should try to work and adopt the DNA of PESA. We only have so many pesas around to attract foreign investments, but I think if the local governments put this to heart, that they would want a piece of that action, which is good for their constituents. They can create more jobs in their area. So that's also another area that we find that from the private sector, we need to improve on. Because indirectly, this really helps our competitive position. And the other aspect of which is for the business practitioner is our cost of logistics. Our cost of logistics in the Philippines is one of the highest among the ASEAN countries. There's a study that was made, our cost of logistics is about almost 20% when you total all the costs involved. And this has been brought up in many forums, and I hope that the government and also the local government, a part of this cost on logistics is also the on the aspect of the local government. Okay. So all of this combined will help financing, the logistic, and the importance of DTI in the role that Yusek Perry mentioned, one of the piece, no, is promotion. Promoting, giving proper information on where our market can be developed. Okay? We have earlier, my friend here, Vice President Perry, mentioned about the IT sector, and the other ASEAN countries are more than what we're doing. The same thing applies to the agricultural sector. Okay? Our exports vis-a-vis import is half, while in Thailand it's the reverse. They export more than they double. They export double than what they import. And almost in Indonesia, it's the same thing. So those are critical areas that we can fast track. Okay? And also are the markets that would have a upside to the RCEP. Okay? As mentioned in many of the discussion, our fruits we have, there's a market for it, but we do not have enough production. So these are areas that I think that given focus, that we should be able to catch up. So those are the key areas that...
China, because of some geopolitical issues, my company alone cannot supply what they're looking for, but we were able to find six companies. The six, together with ours, could supply everything this company was looking for. So it took some time to look for these companies, which unfortunately we do not have that database, but it really opened our eyes in saying there is a lot of products, services, competencies here in the Philippines that are not really known or exposed. So that is what we're trying to put together, and as a group, that is what we're promoting now. So we're very happy that we were able to find these other companies, and some are not in the export zone, by the way. So we're trying to build our database. Also, because of the fast technology, how it's moving, we're also working with the academic sector on the last mile training, on the last mile training, we would like, we're more involved in the requirements.
Charging stations for electric cars are actually made in the Philippines, in Cebu. So di natin alam yun. Tapos, yung rare earth magnets for motors ng electric charge ng electric cars, number two ang Philippines to China. There are many more of these things that we can really highlight. Isa pa pala, nung nasa Washington si Presidente, si Sec Fred, nagkaroon ng signing between IMI and Zero Motorcycles, no? So dito na gagawin yung NEA export yung motorcycles, electric motorcycles. Now si IMI from the Ayala Group, they also, of course we all know that they assemble here yung KTMs. And the KTMs are exported all over the world to China. So yung mga ganong mga things hindi natin alam. But it's our job sa government to really highlight all of this and promote this as we go out and attract more investment. So marami kong good opportunities. At saka isa pa pala, yung si Chuneishi sa Balamban, Cebu, they will make the world's first, I'm not sure if I'm getting it correctly, Casamax class cargo vessel na methanol powered. So that will be made in the Philippines for servicing in 2024 or early 2025. So marami ho tayong, marami nangyayari dito sa atin that we have to be highlighting and be proud of. Thank you.
Thank you, Yusek Perry. My colleagues are signaling me that we're running out of time. But before we end the session, I'll give an opportunity for our gentlemen to give us their last remarks before we end the session. I'll start with Asek Glenn. Asek Glenn, please.
Thank you, Jeremy. We know that there are many opportunities waiting for us, as well as challenges. So I'd like to extend our invitation to all our enterprises and stakeholders. We want to serve you, we want to work with you, and we want to help you grow and take opportunities of these FTAs and RCEP. The whole DTI will gear up to serve and assist you along the way. Thank you.
Thank you, Asa Glenn. Yusek Perry.
By working together, we can make things happen in the Philippines. So, salamat po for the collaboration. Thank you.
Mr. Bersalon?
We're very positive for the country. The statement made by President BBM, you know, that make it happen. Of course, our upcoming Philippine Business Conference has a tagline, Vision 2050. You know, for a while I was hesitant. I said 2050, malayo pa yun eh. But then I realized that demographically, our average age now is 25. So I made a bit of research. By 2050, the average age in the Philippines is only 31. So we really have that sweet spot for the next two decades. They are not only productive, but they're consumer also. So I think we know very well European countries, also the likes of Japan and China, they're aging much faster than we are. So it's important for us to really grasp at this opportunity. Okay, education is important, upskilling, I mentioned earlier, but if you go all over around the world, Filipinos, managers, workers, programmers are second to none. So we should be able to have that kind of environment to attract many of our fellow Filipinos, no, to come here and really help the country grow in the next decade. Maraming salamat po.
And last but not the least, Mr. Ferrer.
No, thank you. All I can say is this is our decade. It's Philippines. This is ours. We should claim it. But working together, government and the private sector, it's a force that now I believe should and we should make it happen and make the decade the Philippines decade. Maraming salamat.
Thank you very much, gentlemen, and together we can make it happen. Let's give a round of applause for our panelists. Maraming salamat, sir.
Ida. Thanks again to our esteemed panelists. I will now give the floor to Director Lynn Nakia of the Bureau of International Trade Relations to provide us a synthesis of the discussions. Director Lynn, thank you.
Thank you, Jeremy. Secretary Pascual and honorable secretaries, colleagues from government, members of the diplomatic corps, industry leaders, partners in the academia, civil society, and friends in the media, good afternoon na po. In 5 minutes, I will attempt to synthesize all that has happened today. So first, let me start by recapping some remarks of President Marcos. The President has directed all government agencies to implement the PEDP and to address the constraints to production, focusing on the areas of innovation, improving the ease of doing business, providing finance, improving infrastructure, and focusing on legislative initiatives. The President pointed out the need to develop a strong and innovative export ecosystem. He called on the private sector partners, both domestic and international, to work with the government to help increase the Philippines' mind share in the global market. All this, we need to create more opportunities and jobs for all Filipinos as we strive to be an agile export powerhouse by 2028. Second, President Marcos highlighted the entry into force of the RCEP this month. Like all of the Philippines' free trade agreement, RCEP is a platform to reach bigger markets for our goods and services. Ratifying the RCEP is also a signal that as we remain open for trade and investments, we must support and help improve the competitiveness of our exporters, especially our micro and SMEs. Third, we heard expressions of support from Senator Lauren Legarda and PhilExport President Sergio Ortiz Luis Jr. It was a pleasure to listen to Senator Lauren Legarda, our champion on trade and FTAs at the Senate, and who argued for RCEP so it will be concurred at in Senate. Senator Legarda emphasized the need to effectively curb and cut red tape and corruption so that all laws will be effectively implemented. She also called on the export sector to consider the environment in their planning and production. In doing so, we will have the potential to improve the value of our products and services and respond to a market that is more conscious of sustainable issues. It was also inspiring to hear also from PhilExport President Sergio Ortiz Luis. In Filipino, he said, "There is no giving up and no one will be left behind when we reach our ambition towards a stable, comfortable, and secure life." Fourth, from the session with the embassies and the private sector, there are both opportunities and challenges ahead. Non-tariff barriers continue to exist and the cost of logistics is still high, as pointed out by Mr. Barcelon. Every effort counts. In order to bring the benefits of trade and investments to all, we need everyone. Non-export manufacturing companies are important, as Mr. Pereira said. There are enormous opportunities. Products, services, and competencies that are not yet known, but they are working to promote them. I like that how they are working with the academia to help them. Again, enormous opportunities. I can't help but say, even though Ambassador Wang has left, that we will do our best to send you more durian for the China market. And Economic Minister Nihei, we always appreciate your generous development assistance, especially those that support our industries. My takeaway from this session is that this offers us hope and new ideas at DTI. Most importantly, it challenges us in government to do our job better. By joining forces with the private sector and our stakeholders, we will work to be an export powerhouse. Together, we need to create more opportunities for all Filipinos and be good hosts to all the international companies that have chosen to do business in the Philippines. Fifth and last, we heard from our DTI speakers some good news. Growth is happening despite the challenges and conditions. We also heard that DTI has been working hard. We are moving ahead to attract investments, to upgrade existing FTAs, and to forge new ones. DTI is making sure that the programs that it will build competitive and resilient and domestic and international businesses are in place and running. Sabi nga ni Jeremy, the conversations were very enlightening. And just to show how much at DTI we take our role seriously as an agile organization to make it happen in the Philippines, I want to share that we have invited some of our exporters to join in the afternoon, where there will be clinicking sessions to be led by the Export Marketing Bureau with support from the Bureau of International Trade Relations and other agencies. It is the first of the many activities that will be rolled out nationwide to implement the PEDP and to improve people's knowledge and businesses' utilization of the RCEP and other free trade agreements. Our private sector participants are welcome to join us later, starting at 2 p.m. So to close off on this synthesis, on behalf of the department, let me thank everyone for coming today. Our special thanks to all the speakers and the members of the Secretariat for your generous and special contributions that made this day possible. Secretary Pascual said earlier that today is a historic milestone with the unveiling of the Philippine Export Development Plan 2023 to 2028 and the kickoff of the advocacy campaign in the Philippines for the RCEP agreement. Indeed, it has been a pleasure and an honor to share this morning, this afternoon with you. We hope everyone will keep well and have a good day ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Thank you very much, Director Lin, for the synthesis. Again, thank you everyone for participating this morning. On behalf of Secretary Fred Pascual, the whole DTI XCOM, and the DTI family, we express our profound gratitude to all our attendees and participants for joining this event. We hope that each one of you learned something new today. Again, my name is Jeremy Reyes, reminding everyone to keep safe, stay healthy, and we will have our FTA clinic session this afternoon. Mabuhay everyone, and let's eat lunch. Maraming salamat po.